Lord Jesus, praise the King of Kings and the Lord of Lords. My dear friends, Jesus Christ is Lord. Amen. God sent us here to preach to you about Jesus Christ. Hope that some of you will give your life to Jesus Christ today. Today's message is the seriousness of sin. The seriousness of sin. Now I want you to take this message seriously, because this message will affect the way you live and the way you die, and your whole eternal future may depend on it. This message, the heart of the gospel, the seriousness of sin. This message can get you to heaven, or you may lose it, or you may miss it. And so I want you to listen very carefully about this message, the seriousness of sin. Because I just really want to say two things: sin and forgiveness. Sin and forgiveness. The first one is seriousness of sin. Your sin is deadly, my dear friend. Your sin is costly. Your sin will treat you a way that you can never imagine. And because of this, I want you to treat your sin deadly before your sin will treat you deadly, my dear friend. It says sin will treat us, but sin also kills us. Sin may fascinate us, but sin also terminate us. And so the seriousness of sin is why I want you to listen today. When you sin against God, especially if you keep on sinning against the Holy God, especially if you keep on doing the same thing over and over again, time and time again, listen, my dear friend, you will set up yourself for divine judgment. And if you have never trusted the Lord Jesus Christ as your Lord and your Savior, you will be rejected one of these days. When you stand before the righteous judgment of God. So sin is a serious business with God. Do not take your sin lightly. Do not take sin lightly, my dear friend, because sin has internal consequences. And just to make it any difference, sin does not care who you are. Sin does not care about your status. It makes no difference where you're from, or where your location is, or what is your wealth, or your level, or your name, you name it. It doesn't matter. Sin is disobedient to Holy God. From the beginning of the Bible to the end, God hates sin. Yes, God hates sin. And because of what sin does to his children and his creation. And if God hates sin, then we must indeed be serious concerning this matter of sin. Moreover, what God hates, Satan delights in. And those who practice sin, they please and they serve the devil. The Bible says that you have loved righteousness and hate wickedness. Speaking of God. So when you read the Bible enough, you will find out and you will know that sin is wickedness. Sin is a destroyer. Sin is a spoiler. Sin is a divider, and sin is the roadblock between you and the Holy God. So God hates sin. What is the nature of sin? The true nature of sin is seriousness. First of all, it deceives you, otherwise you will not be doing it. What you are doing right now, because sin, you've been deceived by the devil, you have been deceived by sin, and sin tells you, it is okay, don't worry, continue doing what you are doing. After all, God is God of love, and God loves you, and God understands. But I say to you today, you are mistaken. God loves you, yes, but God hates sin. And because of sin, you are disobedient to the Holy God, and you've been deceived into thinking that you are an exception. There's no exempt in sin. There's no exempt in sin. When you do sin, and when you practice sin, you have been demonized, and you have been deceived by the devil, and you think that you are not breaking God's law. But there's a consequence to sin, because you have been deceived, and that is the deception of sin. Secondly, sin disappoints, and sin always makes big time offers, but guess what? Sin never delivers. Sin will tell you, go and do this with him or her, do this and that. Sin always made Peter offers and makes it to feel fantastic, and yet sin will disappoint you at the end. And so we need to think about this matter of sin, of his disappointment, because many of us today have had our lives in different many ways, in different many times, and yet we understand we've been disappointed at the end because of sin. Now, can you imagine if the person in your life is full of sin, adultery, murder, blaspheme, profanity, pride, adultery, sorcery, drunkenness, envy, jealousy, heresy, perversion, theft, desertion, kidnapping, lying, torture, lawlessness, rebellion. Would you, my dear friend, have such a person as a friend? No way, of course not. The same way God will not have that kind of person. And so this thing has been manifest, and God condemns sin. There's a condemnation of sin. So sin needed to be treated seriously, because you see, my dear friend, sin will make you some unanswered promises, but it cannot deliver, it cannot produce. So sin will give you maybe temporary satisfaction, but sins will never satisfy you at the end, and you end up being heartbroken. Many of us have this experience with sin. So that the disappointment is sin. You only offer you temporary satisfaction. That's the reason many people today are living in sin. But you disappoint them at the end. So sin is a deceiver. And also, my dear friend, sin destroys. So you need to look around today in society and see around the world, and you will find out and you realize how destructive sin is. It might take many different ways, it might take different many routes, but ultimately in the end, sin will destroy you. Sin destroy families, sin destroy marriages, sin destroy jobs, sin destroy future, sin destroy children. You name it, sin is deadly, my dear friend. My message for you today, the seriousness of sin. Sin is deadly by its nature. And I want you to think with me, ultimately, sin brings death. Sin sometimes brings death in a short period. Sin sometimes brings death like instant coffee. Sin sometimes as well prolong your death. If you are living your life today outside Jesus Christ, you continue to deliberately practicing sin. May I tell you today, there's internal consequences concerning your sin. At the end, sin will disappoint you. Sin treats you, but sin kills. The Bible says, the soul who sin shall die. The wages of sin is death. There's a price tag for sin. The wages of sin is death. And Jesus Christ will say to some people in the last day, on that day of judgment, depart from me, depart from me. You have cast into everlasting fire. So that's the worst thing that you can say to anybody. So that's why you need to take sin seriously, my dear friend. Nobody ever say anything more strong than that. And so, if I could stop right here, that would be evil thing, isn't it? That would be a terrible life. But let me continue, because I want to tell you right now about forgiveness of sin. I've talked to you already about sin. Sin disappoints, sin destroys, the wages of sin is death. Let me talk to you, my dear friend, right now about forgiveness of sin. What is the seventh power of sin that brought about this forgiveness? It is the seventh power of the blood of Jesus Christ. I want you to think with me today. If you remember all the way to the Garden of Eden, in Genesis means the beginning. Right there in Genesis chapter 3, you will discover in that perfect Garden of Eden that Adam and Eve had everything going their way. But in the end, they had a choice, like many of us today. God had given them choice. God had given you choice. And what did they do? They disappoint. They disobey. And they sin against God. And the scripture says in Genesis chapter 3 verse 20, the man called his wife Eve, and because she was the mother of all living, and the Lord made for Adam and for his wife garments of skin and clothing. Right there in the beginning, God killed an innocent animal. God killed a lamb and shed the blood and covered them with his skins. There's a shame in sin. There's a fear in sin. There's a destruction in sin. So in the very beginning of the Bible, with the first man who committed sin against God, God shed the blood in their behalf. God began in the very beginning to say, sin demands blood. If you are going to get saved, save the man's blood, and the blood was shed for their sin. So there's a cost to sin, and there's a price of sin is blood. So the seriousness of sin, the price of sin is the blood of Jesus Christ. All the way back to the Garden of Eden, and those people who are living that time, and we are living this time, we know that there's a sin in your life, you need forgiveness. So this issue of sin requires a death. Every time you sin, something dies. God demands blood for the sin. When Jesus Christ came into the world, as you remember when he began to talking about sin, shed out his blood to his disciples and the Lord's Supper. What is all the Lord's Supper is all about? It's all about the blood of Jesus Christ bringing salvation to us. So you can see, this reminds us straight away that Jesus Christ died in agony on that cross of Calvary for our sin, and he paved way for God to redeem us. So sin destroys us. Ultimately, sin will send you to hell. But glory be to Jesus Christ that Jesus Christ came and died for us. And when you receive that blood atonement for your sin, you shall be saved. And when you die, you go to heaven. And that's why we are here to tell you today, the seriousness of sin. Sin demands the blood of Jesus Christ. The message of salvation can be put in four words: redemption, reconciliation, justification, and sanctification. And now the first one is redemption. 1 Peter chapter 1 verse 18 says, knowing that you are ransomed from the vital ways inherited from your forefathers, not with perishable things such as silver or gold. Now that's very interesting. So God took out the most precious thing to us, those things we value. God said, look at your most valuable commodities, they are not good to you. They are not good to you. He said, knowing that you are not redeemed with perishable things like silver or gold for the fighter, which means they produce no result or effect. It is an empty way of life. He says, inherited from your forefathers. Now watch this, but with the precious blood of the Lamb, unblemished and spotless, the blood of Christ. So the first word is redemption. So redemption means that you have been redeemed. You have been bought and paid for by the precious blood of Jesus Christ. And by the way, that's the only thing in existence can take away our sin. He redeemed us. He brought us back from a life of sin into the marvelous light of righteousness and holiness. So the second word is reconciliation. Colossians chapter 1 verse 19 says, for in him, that Jesus Christ, all the fullness of God was pleased to dwell. Now watch this. Through him to reconcile to himself all things, whether in heaven, on the earth, making peace by his blood of his cross. So you can see, my dear friend, we've been redeemed. We have peace with God today because of what Jesus Christ did on the cross of Calvary. Verse 21, and you are once and later separated from God and hostile in mind, doing evil things. He has now reconciled his own body of flesh by his death in order to present you holy and blameless and above reproach before him. My dear friend, sin separates us from God. Is any sin in your life? God will give you social distances. Is any sin in your life? Why not ask God for forgiveness of your sin today, that you might receive the mercy of God? So my dear friend, Jesus Christ reconciled us back to God. When we trust the work he did at the cross of Calvary, we have been reconciled. So there's a redemption. There's a reconciliation. And reconciliation brings us back to God. And reconciliation also brings people back together. If a husband and wife, they're having a problem, maybe divorce or divided, reconciliation brings them back together. Jesus Christ wants to bring you back together to God today. If you have been separated from God due to sin, the word of God is speaking to your heart today, that you can be brought back to God. Jesus Christ said, draw near to me and I will draw near to you. By the way, it's knocking at the door of your heart. If you are willing today to listen to the word of God, the word of God will set you free today. So reconciliation brings sinners to oneness in their relationship. And Jesus Christ in that union and that harmony. The next word is justification. Romans chapter 5 verse 8, the Bible says, God showed his love for us in that, watch this, while we are still sinners, Christ died for us. That's what he says. While we are still sinners, Christ died for us. Christ did not come to die for the righteous. Jesus Christ came and he died for the unrighteous. The just died for the unjust. What does this mean? It means that the ultimate price has been paid. God loves us so much, and God demonstrates this love towards us. While we are still sinners, and he gave his son, Jesus Christ, died for us. So since then we have not been justified by his blood, much more shall we be saved. And by him for the wrath of God, through him, that's through Jesus Christ. So we can see the word justification. It means that God has declared us not guilty anymore. God justified us. God justified the ungodly. Just as if we have not sinned before. It's only God can justify through the precious blood of our Lord Jesus Christ that make that possible in our life. Now, what does this mean? It means if a person rejects Jesus Christ, you are rejected the only person who can take away your sin. That's why you need him. He's the only one who brought justification as reality into our life by shedding his blood on the cross of Calvary. Jesus Christ redeemed us. Jesus Christ reconciled us. Jesus Christ justified us. And my dear friend, another word, sanctification. Jesus Christ sanctified us. Hebrews chapter 13 verse 12, the Bible says that Jesus Christ also suffered once outside the gate in order to sanctify the people through his own blood. With his own blood, he sanctified us. Sanctify means to set something apart. So he says, he has redeemed us, he has reconciled us, he has justified us, and now, my dear friends, he has sanctified us. This is a wonderful thing in the life of a Christian. Christian life, in every aspect of our life, that God is doing something marvelous in us. Sanctification is an art, just like redemption is, but sanctification is a process that goes on and on and on. For example, if someone says, well, if I have sinned after I have been saved, everyone has sinned, and God knew that we will continue to sin. But God also provides a way out for us. Sanctification is the only way that God will redeem us. You see, we have been redeemed once, we have been reconciled once, we have been justified once, but my dear friend, sanctification happened not only once, it's an ongoing thing. It continues to go on and on and on. For example, in Ephesians chapter 1 verse 7 says, but if you walk in the light, as he is in the light, we are fellowship one another. And watch this, the blood of Jesus Christ, his son, cleanse us from all sins. Verse 8, if we say we have not sinned, we deceive ourselves and the truth is not in us. So what does this mean? It means that if we agree with God that we have sinned against him, the Bible says he's faithful and just and righteous to forgive us and cleanse us from every of our sins. Sanctification. Continually, God cleans us from all sin. So you see, God redeemed us once and for all. God reconciled us once and for all. God justified us once and for all. But the scripture says right now, God sanctifies us and continually cleans us. It's a cleaning process. Knowing that God knows that we can never be perfect. He knows that we still have the sin nature within us. And God provided a way out for us through sanctification. It's a continual cleansing process. So my dear friend, if you confess your sin, the Bible says it's faithful and just to forgive us from every of our sins and to cleanse us from every unrighteousness. Many people today might use this verse as a cover for them to continue to practice in sin. But I want you to take your sin so serious, my dear friend. Recognize every time that when you sin, it's not against the Holy God. But you can come to him for forgiveness of sin, and you receive this forgiveness based on what Jesus Christ did on the cross. He shed his blood, which he did once and for all, but this sanctification continues to go every single time. All sin that have been paid for, the past, the present, and the future sin have been paid. But then again, can a Christian sin? He can sin. Should a Christian sin? No. But when you sin, there's a way out for you. The blood of Jesus Christ cleans us every single day. So sin is a serious business with God. And because it's so serious that it cost God his own begotten son, Jesus Christ. He shed his blood, and God looking at humanity, knowing that every one of us need a way out, knowing that you're going to sin against him, knowing that we're going to be separated from him for all eternity from him, unless God did something about it. And God did something about it, started right there in the Garden of Eden with the first couple, atoning for that sin by shedding the blood right there from throughout the Old Testament and throughout the New Testament. We can now look back. The people in the Old Testament were looking forward. The people now in the New Testament were looking back what Jesus Christ did for us. Jesus Christ was crucified for our sins. Jesus Christ died and bear our sin debt so that we can be justified, we can be satisfied, we can be glorified, and we can be redeemed through his precious blood. So Jesus Christ said in the book of Luke chapter 9 verse 23, if anyone will come after me, listen to this, let him deny himself and take up his cross daily and follow me. Christ died and suffered on the cross in order that you and I could have a relationship with God. Even our weaknesses, we have been forgiven. Because God loves us, and God's love never ends. It is everlasting love, my dear friend. So you, my friend, I want you to get right with God today. You see, just why I end up in cross to die for our sins. He substitute my life, he substitute your life, he substitute our life for his life. There's a life in the blood. Christ died for our sins that we can know God. Now the question here is this, have you believed the message of the cross? Because you have not believed. If you die outside Jesus Christ, when you die, you go to hell. And yes, and that's true. The wages of sin is death. Now what is, but the free gift of life is his eternal life, is in Christ Jesus. So when you die in Christ Jesus, you have eternal life. So sin enter into humanity, and to this present moment, only one thing that can throw our sin, that can take care of our sin, that can bring us forgiveness of our sin, is the blood of one man, the person of our Lord Jesus Christ, shed his blood to turn for our sin and for the sins of the world. My dear friend, you don't have another choice. You see, from the beginning of the Bible talks about his coming, he came. The Bible talks about his coming again, and he's coming again. The question here is this, have you come to grasp and thanks with your sinful lifestyle? Why not thank God today that I'm a sinner? I need to be forgiven. I forsake my sins. I receive Jesus Christ as my Lord and as my Savior. I surrender everything to him. And I believe that I will live for him. My dear friend, if you made this confession, God will send the Holy Spirit of God. When the Holy Spirit of God comes in your life, he will teach you to be above sin. He will enable you to navigate in this world. The Holy Spirit of God is like a GPS. He will tell you not to go to this place. He will tell you not to talk to this person. He will tell you not to do that. He will tell you not to do that, because the Spirit of God is controlling you. You see, forgiveness is not shame. Forgiveness calls God because his son. Jesus Christ shed his blood on the cross of Calvary and atoned for our sin. And because of this, my dear friend, we receive forgiveness and we receive mercy and we receive grace. Not because we are good, not because we are better, but because Jesus Christ died for us. And when you trust him, my dear friend, he will send the Holy Spirit of God, the third person in the Trinity, into your life to enable you to live above sin, to enable you to be righteous and to live holy. Let me remind you, if you don't come to Jesus Christ, my dear friend, in your sin you will die. And you cannot make it into the kingdom of God. You'll be separated forever from the presence of God. And because of this, we are here to encourage you that you can give your life to Jesus Christ and he will set you free. The message is two-point message. Sin and forgiveness. You can never get wrong with that. You sin and God forgive our sin. But you have to receive Jesus Christ and open his precious blood that your sin can be forgiven. This is the message of seriousness of sin. It is about the blood of Jesus Christ. It is all about the forgiveness. It is all about the cleansing. It is all about God. It is all about the awesome restoration of our life that Jesus Christ has rescued us and put our names in the Lamb Book of Life. The only person who can get you to heaven is Jesus Christ. By his sacrificial life that he died for us, he substituted for us on that cross of Calvary. And when we receive him, he make it possible for us to have forgiveness, and he cleans us that we won't die we can go back to God. That's all you want in this life. Amen. There's nothing in this life, my dear friend. Your money will save you. Your beauty will save you. Your good ending will save you. Your cast will save you. When you die, you are going to stand one-to-one with the Holy God of Israel. The question is this, have you given your life to him? Because you have not done that, you can do that today. Just say, Jesus Christ, come into my heart. God bless you, man. Merry Christmas. Merry Christmas. Amen. So receive Jesus Christ today into your heart, and you will receive everlasting life. The man blessed in the mighty name of Jesus. Jesus Christ is Lord. Amen. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Amen. Amen.